Welcome back. The relationship between the United States and Israel has never been this tense, with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu just days away from making a controversial speech to Congress. Tensions are at a boiling point. And among American Jews, there's a war within. J Street bills itself as the political home of the pro-Israel, pro-peace movement. This week, J Street ran a full-page ad in the New York Times against the speech by Netanyahu, saying that his speech was a prop for his election campaign in Israel. Netanyahu has accused the White House and other world powers of rolling over and allowing Iran to develop a nuclear bomb. And more conservative Jewish groups like AIPAC stand firmly behind Netanyahu. Let's dig into this with both sides. Joining me now is the president of J Street, Jeremy Ben-Ami, and attorney Alan Dershowitz, who's been friends with Netanyahu for more than 30 years, will be meeting with him this week and will attend the speech this week. Jeremy, let me begin with you. The ad says, well, he's using it as a prop for his campaign at home, but the response from Prime Minister Netanyahu is to say, wait a minute, Congress has an important role to play in this issue, and I'm coming to influence the Congress. What's wrong with that?
Well, I think one of the things he could have done is delayed the speech until after his election. That's what you called for in our campaign over the last few weeks. If the interest at stake here is a serious discussion of Iran policy, there are ways to do that in a closed-door setting. There's ways to do it through back channels. There's ways to do it after the election. This kind of appearance has been used in the past by the prime minister as a campaign ad, and that's where you inject the partisan agenda that defeats your policy agenda in the long run.
Professor, why not delay the speech for a month?
Because the deal might very well have been struck by then. You know, we're told by John Kerry that it's too early to criticize the deal, but once the deal is made, we'll be told it's too late. Let's look at the big picture. This is the most important foreign policy decision of this century. Giving Iran, which is the greatest exporter of terrorism, nuclear weapons to put on their ICBMs will change, as President Obama said, will become a game changer. Liberal senators like Senator Menendez and others oppose this. David Brooks of the New York Times opposes it. Henry Kissinger, the Washington Post editorial page. So many well-regarded liberals and conservatives think this is a bad deal, particularly the sunset provision. Let's give Prime Minister Netanyahu a chance to make his case. Congress has equal power in foreign policy to the president. The Speaker of the House was entirely within his power to invite him. Let everybody come and listen. I would like to ask Jeremy Ben-Ami whether he supports the boycott of Israel by some liberal Democrats, or whether he would join me in urging everybody to come, listen to the speech, then make up your mind to see whether or not this was good or bad for the United States and for Israel. Jeremy, what do you think?
Go ahead, Jeremy.
Well, I think the issue isn't giving Iran nuclear weapons, Alan. I think that we can agree, and I think President Obama agrees with all the leaders of the P5 plus one, that the goal of this entire enterprise is to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. And the question isn't whether or not the president, or in some way through this deal, other countries are trying to help Iran get a nuclear weapon. It's whether or not this is the best way to prevent it. If there is no deal, then Iran will proceed unimpeded towards a nuclear weapon. If there is a deal, then we've got at least 10 to 15 years of very strict, intrusive inspections, real limits, sanctions that remain in place and are only gradually reduced. This is the best way to achieve our shared goal of having no nuclear weapons for Iran.
Professor, I'll give you the floor back
in a
moment, but Jeremy,
point.
Wait, I do want to ask the question, though, of Jeremy, to Professor Dershowitz's point. Should Democrats, because they're the ones who are in opposition to this, stay away from the speech, or do you agree with Professor Dershowitz, Jeremy, that everyone should attend?
Well, it's an individual decision for members of Congress to make. That's not the issue. The issue is whether or not this speech has actually set back Israel's national interests. Has this speech done damage the way it was concocted to the U.S.-Israel relationship? That's what the former director of the Mossad, Meir Dagan, just said in an intensely detailed interview, saying that nobody's done more damage to the U.S.-Israel strategic relationship than Prime Minister Netanyahu and the way that he's gone about his relationship with the White House. And that's the problem with this speech.
Professor, when Susan Rice, Ambassador Rice, is using words like destructive to discuss the U.S.-Israeli relationship, would you concede, indeed, significant damage has been done, or do you believe it's repairable?
Oh, I think it's repairable, and I think we won't know until we hear the speech. The speech is going to be critical. If it persuades members of Congress to serve their constitutional function of checking and balancing a very bad deal, and, you know, it's very debatable, this deal. As I said, many, many good people, liberal Democrats, don't agree with Ben-Ami, and they think within 5 or 6 years, the sunset provisions will begin to kick in, and Iran will be guaranteed a nuclear weapon. If that's the case, let's see if Prime Minister Netanyahu can persuade Congress. If he can, then it will be good for the relationship. People forget that Congress has as much power over foreign policy as the president does under the Constitution, and it must serve as a check and balance. And we will see whether or not Congress is persuaded that Jeremy Ben-Ami is right, that this is the best way to do it, or whether increased sanctions. Nobody wants to put the military option on the table except as an absolute last resort. But increasing sanctions, rather than giving them a sunset provision, which will send a green light not only to Iran, but to Saudi Arabia, the Emirates, and Egypt, all of which will start getting into an arms race. Let's have this debate in front of Congress. Everybody, come and listen to the Prime Minister, then make up your mind, but don't boycott an American ally. A boycott is for people like Ahmadinejad. You walk out on bigots, but you come and listen to allies, even if you disagree with the way in which this was set up. And reasonable people could have disagreement, but come and listen, make up your mind based on the facts and based on the arguments you hear on both sides.
Jeremy, do we know enough about the deal to be taking such positions at this juncture?
Well, I think the broad outlines are becoming very clear. The broad outlines are that Iran is going to have the ability to enrich to a certain extent that is appropriate for civilian purposes only. There will be the most intense and intrusive inspection regime that has ever been imposed on any regime. And there will be a gradual loosening of the sanctions in return for actual compliance with the terms of the agreement. And that's the broad outlines of the agreement. And it turns out that 84% of Jewish Americans support a deal like that that helps to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. And there are just as many Republican experts and foreign policy professionals and editorial boards who support that approach to dealing with the Iranian threat as oppose it. And I agree, there's a policy debate to be had. But the question here is whether or not the Prime Minister, his ambassador, and the Speaker of the House have injected partisan politics in an inappropriate way into the middle of the U.S.-Israel relationship in a way that damages that relationship for the long run.
Gentlemen, I think this was a productive conversation, and I appreciate Jeremy Ben-Ami and Alan Dershowitz for having been here to have it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.